Hi viewers, this is Salahuddin and today's lecture number 32. In the previous lecture we talked about the industrial revolution, impacts of industrial revolution, causes of industrial revolution and course of the revolution. Today we will talk about Pitt, who remained Prime Minister of England. We will talk about the policies, domestic policies and his foreign policies. So coming to the topic, Pitt the Younger, who remained Prime Minister, of England for two times. He is known as Pitt the Younger because his father was also Pitt. And this, who he was the older Pitt, elder Pitt, and this one is the Pitt the Younger. Pitt was born in 1759 and died in 1806. He was second son of his parents. He got education at home because of his ill health, and he was taught at Cambridge till he reached to the age of 15. So this is a very short introduction, and now we will talk about when he was his Prime Minister. He became member of the parliament at the age of 21, and in 1983 he became Prime Minister of England. At that very year, 1783, he was made Chancellor of Exchequer, that we call it the finance minister here in Pakistan. And then in the same year, 1783, he became Prime Minister of England. He remained PM for two times. First, when he became Prime Minister from 1783 till 1801, and then he resigned, and again he was made Prime Minister by George III in 1804 to 1806 when he died. So this was all about Pitt the Younger. Now we will come to the very important section or important part of this topic, and that is domestic policy of Pitt the Younger. We are going to divide his policy, domestic policy as well as foreign policy, into eras. The first one is the domestic policy of Pitt before the French Revolution, and then the domestic policies of Pitt after French Revolution. And same is the case with the foreign policy, his policy before the French Revolution, and then his foreign policy after the French Revolution. So coming to the domestic policy of Pitt the Younger. When he became PM of England, the image of England was already tarnished due to the American War of Independence, where they were defeated in 1774. National debt was already on rise, and there were social political issues all over in England. The issue of Ireland was also lurking on the mind of Pitt the Younger, which was a very important issue at that time. So at this time the situation was in topsy-turvy, and there were financial crises, and what he wanted in this meantime of crisis, he tried to maintain the policy of peace and tranquility and retrenchment. So this was simple about his the condition when he was modifying his domestic policy. So coming to the main point, domestic policy before the French Revolution. French Revolution took place in 1789. So what was the Pitt's policy before this revolution? He brought many reforms during the period from 1783 to 1793, means this span of 10 years he brought many reforms. The first one is the financial reforms, which includes the following reforms: lowering the national debt, because the national debt was already on rise due to defeat in American War of Independence. The country was under heavy debt of 25 crore pound. A sinking fund of 1 million a year was created. Thus, the financial situation were regaining some kind of stability. So in the financial reform, he lower or decrease the national debt of the country. Secondly, economy and the government expenditure. He tried to maintain the policy of austerity in his government, and he abolished certain superfluous jobs, which was already quenching the economy of England. So economy and the governance expenditure was another important aspect of his domestic policy. The third one is the reduction in duties. He reduced duties on certain foodstuffs, like the duty was 50% before Pitt, but now he decreased it to 12%. And on some commodities, the duty was altogether abolished. He imposed taxes on some other items like hide, silk, and certain luxury goods. So this reduction in duties helped in alleviating or assuaging the crisis, economic crisis. The fourth important aspect of his domestic policy in the domain of economy was free trade between England and Ireland. We will talk about Ireland, and Ireland was at that time in a kind of war-like situation with England, where it was claimed as the part of England, but certain revolts were already taking place, taking the lives of people and making the situation very dangerous for people. So they were not on good terms. So when Pitt came to the power, he tried to establish a free trade policy with Ireland. In accordance with the laissez-faire theory of Adam Smith, a plan was made to establish free trade between England and Ireland. But this scheme could not work due to opposition in the parliament, because Ireland was was a state, the part of England where the landlords, the feudal lords, they were holding land and farmhouses in Ireland and ruling here in England. So it was not in the interest of the those feudal lords and those some other lords to have a kind of balanced relation and trade with Ireland, because what they would produce here in England would sell them out to Ireland. So thus he tried to establish a trade relation with Ireland, but due to certain opposition in the parliament, Pitt the Younger could not succeed. Then commercial treaty was with France. Pitt put forward a proposal that the right to send a representative from the Rottenborgs should be withdrawn, because most of the people from the southern and eastern England has settled in northern and western part of England. But this bill could not be passed because of the king and other people. Pitt tried to establish a commercial relation with France as well. But when it comes to the interest of the feudal lords, they were not in favor of establishing the same relation with France. Therefore, when a bill was introduced, where it was mentioned to have a kind of commercial relation with France, this bill was outrightly rejected in the parliament. So these were certain reforms in the economic aspects, from the economic point of view. The second important point is the domestic policy was parliamentary reforms. In parliamentary reforms, Pitt proposed to give representation to new cities and try to compensate the honours of the Brogue by paying them £1 lakh. But this bill could not be succeeded because of King and others. Now, England was becoming a kind of populated country. Industrial towns were establishing, factories were establishing, and thus people were migrating from the other parts of the country to the main cities. And they had no right to vote. When Pitt tried to bring those people to the mainstream by giving them the right of vote, this was simply abhorred by the landlords, and the king himself was not in favor of such a bill. So this bill was again rejected. What he tried was to bring parliamentary reforms, where he was a kind of a democratic person, Pitt the Younger. And the third aspects of the domestic policy is the attempt to end the slave trade. It was the time when the trade of slave was very common in England and even in America. In 1788, Pitt got the bill to pass by the parliament according to which the number of slaves required in a ship was limited. He tried his best to end slave trade, but could not succeed because of strong opposition. So the slaves that they would catch in Africa, in other colonies, and would send them to other part of her colonies. If a ship could carry 500 slaves, they would board on them 1,000 slaves. So thus he tried to pass a bill in the parliament by which the required number of slaves must be limited to their defined limit. And secondly, all those people who are dealing in trades, in slave trades, must have a definite number of slaves, rather of unlimited or infinite number of slaves. But this bill was also rejected by the Parliament of England. The fourth important aspect of his domestic policy was Pitt's India Act of 1784. In this Act of 1784, the Pitt India Act passed, according to which a board of control was established, and this board of control was looking after the commercial side or the commercial activities. So this board was established in the subcontinent here in India, where it would look after the commercial side and the commercial activities. This was another reform or another aspect of his domestic policy. And then the fifth one is the Canada Act of 1791. Pitt got the Canada Act passed. According to it, Canada was divided into two parts, the southern and the northern Canada. In the northern, mostly English people were inhabited, while in the southern, French people, they were inhabited. So thus, these both the northern and southern parts of Canada showed some kind of allegiance and assisted them in administering in the administration of the Canada. Thus, their grievances their negative attitude for each other was also bridged with the passage of time, due to the northern and southern parts of the Canada. So these were the policies he adopted in domestic domain before the French Revolution. Now we will talk about his domestic policy after French Revolution. French Revolution, in the coming part we will talk about it in detail, which casted very severe impacts on all over the world, especially on England. So coming to the domestic policy after the French Revolution, so Pitt adopted the following important measures keeping in view his domestic policy. The first one is the Alien Act of 1793. This policy starts from 1793, where French Revolution took place in 1789. The first important aspect of his domestic policy after French Revolution was the Alien Act of 1793. According to this act, all the foreigners who were found instigating the English on the lines of the French Revolution were to be shouted out of the country. According to this act, anyone found instigating people in the line of the French Revolution should be kicked out of the country. Secondly, the Habeas Corpus Act of 1795. And according to this act, which was suspended for some time, and under this act, anyone could be arrested without warrant even, and could be pushed or put behind bars without any trial for unlimited time, for unlimited period of time. On the basis of doubtful infidelity, mean loyalty to the country. So under Habeas Corpus Act, anybody could be put behind the bars, and the person must not be given access to be tried in the courts. The third aspect of domestic policy of the French Revolution was the Suppression of Society Act. According to this act, all those society which spread a work on revolution was banned. So all those societies who were working, even if it was the trade society, even if it was the civil society, even if it was the society related to literary circles, so all those societies were suppressed so that the evils of the French Revolution may not be given a kind of birth here in England, or to keep safe England from the same kind of revolution. And then the fourth one was the Seditious Meeting Bill was also passed, and according to this bill, all the political parties in England, they were banned and they could not hold any public meeting or protest. And after the Seditious Meeting Bill was passed, no one or no party had the right to have a kind of congregation or some kind of meeting even or a protest under this act. Then the Treason Act was also part during this time after the French Revolution, and according to this act, anyone who expressed his opposing views against the government was declared a traitor and was severely punished for that offense. So the Treason Act, under this act, anyone having a kind of opposite views or having views against the government could be declared as a traitor, and the traitor, and they would reward them or punish them very severely under this act. And then the sixth one is censor on newspaper. Censor was also clamped on newspaper to eradicate the evil of the French Revolution from England. And the same censorship was also imposed on other literary works, even on those great writers. They were also under severe suppression due to this censor act, so that the evils of the French Revolution may not reach here in England. And then the seventh one is Pitt become a conservative from liberal. How he become conservative from liberal? Earlier he was in favor of reforms, that could be political reforms or parliamentary reforms, or giving right to the to those having no right of food. If it comes to the Irish Home Rule Bill, that the Irish must be given independence, or any other reforms. Now he was deadly against such democratic reform. That's why we say that he became a conservative from liberal. So this was all about his domestic policy. In the first part, we talked about the domestic policy prior to French Revolution, which starts from 1783 to 1793. And then again, we talked about the reform, the domestic policy, which was followed after the French Revolution, starting from 1793 until he was Prime Minister till 1806. Now we will talk about the foreign policy of Pitt the Younger. This policy, we will also divide it into two aspects. The first one is foreign policy of Pitt the Younger before French Revolution, and then the Pitt foreign policy after the French Revolution, similarly to the domestic policy. First, we will talk about before the French Revolution, his foreign policy before the French Revolution. And that is trade treaty with France. Under this treaty, that we also talked about in the domestic policies of Pitt the Younger in terms of reviving economy of England, but now we will talk about from the foreign policy aspect. Trade treaty with France in 1786, and as we talked about earlier in the start of the lecture, that his policy was based on peace, tranquility, and mending good relation, forging good relation with the neighbors, especially with France. So according to this treaty, England decrease the rate of duty imposed on the import of French goods, and similarly France also cut such taxes on the British goods, which resultantly increase the import and export of goods between the two great powers of England. According to this treaty, the duties, which earlier was of a huge amount, which could lead the trade to a kind of depression, but now the duties were reduced to great extent, and on certain commodities even it was completely abolished, which resultantly increased the trade between the two great powers, England and France. So this was the past aspects in foreign policy, where a trade deal was signed in 1786 with France. The second is improvement in relation with Prussia and Holland. Prussia, Holland, they were also great powers at that time. And Frederick William, who was the son of Frederick, succeeded his father, and he was not very much against England, unlike his father Frederick, and thus relations started improving between Prussia and England. In 1788, Pitt, with the help of Prussia and Holland, made a triple alliance. Now, the only enemy of England could be France and Russia. So, mending relation with Prussia and Holland is a result of which an alliance came into being, which is known as Triple Alliance. And in this Triple Alliance, there were three countries of Europe, and those were England, Prussia and Holland. Earlier, they would have a kind of commercial interest in the colonized areas. Thus, they would remain a dagger drawn with each other. Now, the relation between these three countries were greatly improved, and thus the only two enemies, which were also great powers in the palm of France and England, were isolated. Are only these two countries which could endanger the security of England. This Triple Alliance came into being due to the efforts of Pitt the Younger. And now, reduction in the influence of Russia. Pitt helped Sweden with the British help, the King of Sweden, Gustav II, was able to remove Russia from the Baltic Sea. And Baltic Sea was of great interest for England, because England would carry out her commercial activities through Baltic Sea. And at that time, sea was the only route where they could carry out the commercial activities with other countries, or even with the colonies. Now, with the help of help of British, Sweden become able to sit aside or force the Russia to keep them away from the Baltic Sea. So the influence on the Baltic Sea was greatly reduced with the help of the England. So reduction in the influence of England Russia was reduced. These were Pitt's policies which he followed in the meantime before French Revolution. Now we will talk about the policies after the French Revolution, the foreign policy after the French Revolution he adopted. In February 1793, France declared war against England, and at such a critical juncture, Pitt entered into three kind of alliances or three kind of agreement with the European countries. Or Pitt formed three kind of alliances when France attacked England. The first one is known as the Pest Coalition, which took place from 1732 to 1797. Now you can ask a question like how, when Pitt came or Pitt became the Prime Minister in 1793 and the coalition was forged in 1732. So the answer to this question is they had an alliance, but the alliance was waning or getting weaker with the passage of time. But now this alliance was renewed and got strengthened when Pitt came into power, keeping and bearing in mind the current situation. So the Pest Coalition, which took place in 1732 to 1797, and Pitt established this with Austria, Prussia, and Spain and Holland. And England very liberally and openly helped these nations with money so that they could fight against Napoleon, or so they could fight against France bravely. So the alliance of Prussia, Austria, Spain and Holland with the help of England was of great advantage for the other part of the Europe, especially those the allies of England, to defeat France or to defeat the Napoleon. Because Napoleon had started wars and conquering all the countries of Europe. And we are talking about the policy that was adopted by Pitt after the French Revolution. So all these countries united against France when France attacked England, and the other other minor powers or countries, they had also this fear that they can be attacked anytime by France or Napoleon. But this coalition broke in 1797, though in this war Napoleon or France brought part very bravely. The second coalition was established in 1798 to 1801. So why this coalition was establishing and then breaking and then again establishing? The purpose behind the establishing coalition was that every country had her own interest, and we see and we also observe that there is no permanent foe or friend in the international relations. Every country is her own interest. So that's why if it is in the interest of one country, it might not be in the interest of another country. So the coalition could be broken down. And if it is in the interest of two countries, then definitely coalition could be formed. So the second coalition was forged made in 1798, and it was lasted till 1801, Pitt organized this second coalition and comprising of Austria, Russia, and Turkey. Earlier, Russia was a dead enemy of England, and now England has become the friend of Russia due to the war against France, because Napoleon was fighting bravely and floundering everything coming in his way. So he entered into coalition, and that coalition is known as Second Coalition, and the Second Coalition included the country of Austria, Russia, Turkey, and England. Lord Addington, who was succeeded Pitt, succeeded Pitt and entered into an agreement with France. Why Pitt was removed from the job now? Pitt had put a bill in the parliament, and the bill was about to remove the tithes imposed on the Catholics. And when the bill was flatly rejected by the parliament, he also resigned by rejecting the bill that he tabled in the parliament. And the bill was about Catholic emancipation, that those certain restrictions imposed on the Catholics should be removed now to some extent. But when this bill was rejected, he was removed from he resigned from his premiership, and Lord Addington, he was made the Prime Minister of England at that time, after Pitt the Younger. So when Addington entered into an agreement with France, and that agreement is known as Treaty of Amiens, which to certain extent reduced the harshness between the two countries, but it also not lasted very long. And the agreement, this treaty that took place between France and England, and which is known as Treaty of Amiens, and it was signed at the place known as Amiens by Britain, France, Spain, and Batavia, which is nowadays known as Netherlands, which lasted for only 14 months during the Napoleonic Wars. Now coming to the third coalition, and the third coalition that took place in 1805, the Treaty of Amiens that took place between France and England could not lessen the bitterness between England and France. So George III, who was the king at that time, once again brought back Pitt the Younger as a prime minister, who resigned in 1804. Now he again became prime minister in 1804. Pitt organized the third coalition, and which included Russia, Austria, and Sweden in 1805. At this time, the country's condition was the worst, because Napoleon was inflicting a very severe kind of in a position defeating England everywhere, and he was inflicting miseries on England in every aspect, where the condition in the England was very worst at that time. And now it was the time, 1806, when Pitt the Younger died. And when he was ill on his death Biden, he was saying that how I am leaving my country in such a terrible situation. So he died at the age of 47 in 1806. These coalitions were basically formed against France, because Napoleon was without reign, he was unbridled now. Now coming to the Pitt's Irish policy. In 1800, Pitt got merged England and Ireland into one nation, and the following circumstances led to the unification of both Ireland and England. The situation in Ireland was very, very miserable. Their political, social, and economic. So those situation in England was Ireland was very terrible, and it was probably because of England, because the people living in England, they had the reins in their hands. So thus their domestic policies, they were, and foreign policy, everything was in the hand of the people in England. So thus the people of Ireland were seeking independence, and they were fighting this war of independence in the line of American War of Independence, that America got independence from England, and one day we can also succeed to get independence from England. But they were not letting, England was not letting her to seek independence. They could suppress all such movements and some protests. But Pitt thought that suppression could not last very long, so it is necessary to merge Ireland with England equally. First, we will talk about the condition in Ireland. The people of Ireland were influenced by the War of Independence that we talked about. They were influenced by the American War of Independence. In America, in Ireland, certain restrictions, limitations were imposed on the Catholics of Ireland, that we talked in the previous lecture, jo humne pehle baat ki iski. And then the peasants were forced to pay heavy land taxes even. So the farmers, there were also certain restrictions. The Catholics, they were also under certain restriction imposed on them religiously, and the administration of Ireland was completely under the control of English, and certain corrupt people were there who was exploiting the people of Ireland badly. So these were the conditions which felt the need to merge them with England. Pitt had done with the people under such condition in England, where they were protesting against. So he suppressed a revolt in 1798 in Ireland, in an association of an association of United Irishmen was established in Ireland, and its leader was Walton. In this revolt, Catholics killed many Protestants, and the situation was very miserable and very very tough for England. But at last, Pitt was succeeded in suppressing such revolts and protests. because it was a society, or it was a kind of association, United Irish men who were seeking independence from England. But this succession of the United Irish men was finally defeated or suppressed successfully by Pitt the Younger. Now when the union between Ireland and Britain took place, so what were the conditions when this union was taking place? This part of the question is really important. In examination, they can ask a question, describe the union between Ireland and England, or what were the clauses of the union of Ireland and England. The union of Great Britain and Ireland took place in 1800. The Parliament of Ireland passed the Act of Union, whose provision are as follows. The Ireland had also a Parliament, and who passed this Act to get merged with England. And the conditions are the provision of the union, the Act of Union that was passed by the Irish Parliament are the following. The Irish Parliament was dissolved and was merged with the British Parliament, right? The Parliament of Ireland should be abolished and should be merged with the English Parliament. Ireland got the right to send 100 members to the House of Commons and 32 members to the House of Lords. So they had equal representation, 100 members from the House of Commons and 100 from the Britain, and 32 from the House of Lords from Ireland and 32 from the House of Lords from England. Then complete commercial equality was established between England and Ireland. They had complete commercial equality. Now they could Ireland could establish her commercial relation with any part of the world, came with any colonies, and with the and can take her good goods or his or her steps, her good stuffs or any other stuffs in her own ships. Earlier, the food stuffs are the goods farmed and are produced in Ireland would be sent through the English ships. Now this commercial activity or this commercial equality was established where Ireland on her own forged commercial relation of her own interest with any country. So commercial equality was established, and Ireland was given the right to have her own judiciary. Ireland would have her own judiciary, and the Catholic Relief Bill was also passed, and fit try to remove all the curbs imposed on the Catholics, but the king was not in favor, and certain landlords were also not in favor, though certain restriction imposed on the Catholics were removed, but not all those restrictions were removed, because king was not in favor of removing the Catholic restriction and other landlords. due to which Pitt also resigned in 1801 that we talked about, that he put forward this bill in the domestic policy that we talked about, but this bill was flatly rejected. And then effects of the union of England and Ireland. So what were the effects? The union fruit costly affair because of the following pacts. At least some curbs on the Catholics remain as usual. So, effects of the union, though the first one is the certain restriction that were imposed on Catholics were removed, while the other remained. The administration of Ireland was still full of corruption. Still, the administration was in the hand of English people, which were of corrupt, full of corruption. The English goods being cheap, easily gained market in Ireland, but the Irish good could not be sold in the English market. So Ireland had to bear a heavy loss both in trade and industry. The English goods, those were cheap in the Ireland, in the market of Ireland, while the Irish goods could not compete the English goods in England. Thus, these are certain reservations, like there was, the administration was full of corruption still. Catholic emancipation was not fully passed, or those all restrictions were not completely abolished. And secondly, the commercial interest, or the English goods, were of superior nature as compared to the Irish goods, which could not compete the English goods, which where the English had to bear the brunt of this aspect. And the fourth important effect of the Union is the peasants of Ireland continue to be exploited as usual, because many people called Pitt's Irish policy as a great failure, because the peasants in Ireland, they were exploited by the English. The landlord sitting here in the parliament in England would dictate here from England in the Ireland, where the peasants, the tenants and the farmers, they were very badly exploited for enriching their own pockets and making money. So thus the Act of Union had also certain provisions that we talked about, and then we talked about the effects of the Act of Union. This was all about Pitt the Younger. Let's have a quick review of the Pitt the Younger. We talked about Pitt as a Prime Minister. Then we talked about the domestic policy, the before French Revolution and after French Revolution. Then we talked about the foreign policy before French Revolution and after French Revolution. And then we talked about the Pitt's Irish policy, where we talked about the condition in Ireland. Then we talked about the union of Ireland and England, those clauses. And then we talked about the effects of the Union of England and Ireland. So thank you so much for watching the video, and if there is any question, you must ask in the comment section, and hopefully I'm trying to respond you to the best. So thank you so much.